Peace and love, y'all. It's your brother Avis, and we're back with another episode of What's the Word Wednesdays, episode 19. So, as we usually do, and you're coming in, I'm throwing up the logo. And as you do come in, please let me know, how are you feeling today, and what's the word? And I see Instagram did a little stuff that's different with how I can post certain stuff. But for today's show, we're going to be getting into these three topics, which we have. One, we're going to be getting into current events, so basically seeing what's going on currently. What's going on, Cuzzle? Three rounds boxing in the building. I'm stumbling on that, but it's all good. So, we're going to be getting into current events today. Second thing we're going to be talking about, we're going to be getting into... Had to switch, I see, brother. The four levels of understanding. And this is from my perspective when it comes to the understanding. And lastly, we're going to talk about, where does true learning come from? Like, where does that originate? And what do we talk about in that whole aspect of what learning is? So, we're going to vibe out a little bit. Playing in the background right now, we got some Dead Prez with the track, which I'm correct, it is Learning, Growing, and Changing. And this is on their album, The Information Age. That is a very fire album, very insightful, especially right now. Well, what's good, Cuzzo? What's going on? Tell me, what's the word? No disputing the facts. Yo, I'm sorry if I woke you up, but when I open up, it's like you smoking, but I'm high off the people. Watch me soak it up. Huey said the best education is observation and participation. Study how the people. Yeah, so the first half, we just come in, just letting people get accustomed. And then after that, we play the show song, and we get started. You can use, make it something you can do. And once again, Cuzzo, shout out to you for hosting your first ever event and it being successful. So, shouts out to you again. Congrats on that, brother. Don't be afraid to change, y'all.
It's okay to say you don't know. When you let go your ego, you're free from all illusion. Dick, can't make moves in confusion.
Nope.
Don't look for conflict, man. Always look for the solution. My pop said humility is a sign of wisdom. But to really soak it in, now that's a different kind of listener.
And with that, let's get this show going on.
Yeah, peace to anybody.
Hey! I'm hyped, bro. Can't wait to see it.
And the serial skill.
But real quick though, what's the word, y'all? What's the word? 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 Once again, this is your brother Avis, and we are back again with another episode of What's the Word Wednesday, and this is episode 19. So thank you to everyone that is here, and for those to come later and watch the show, shouts out to y'all, love and respect. With further ado, three topics we're getting in today. Current events, as we usually do. Got to talk about what's going on currently. Got everybody mixed up, upside down, all around. And then second, we're going to get into the four levels of understanding. And these are levels that I've come to have from my own thoughts and my own perspective of just watching life and breaking words down. And lastly, we're going to talk about, where does true learning come from? And in quotes, true learning. And with that, those are going to be three topics for the show. Anybody is more welcome to put any other topics or anything that's on their mind and whatever is concerning them. You're more than welcome to put them in the comments, as well as you are welcome to also join the live and to have a back and forth reasoning and talk with me and just the community, because at the end of the day, this is not only just for me to be talking to the screen, this is for the community as a whole, for us to reach a higher understanding and a higher perspective, and really just to really build on different multitudes when it comes to our thought and thinking, critical thinking process. With that, what's up, Janet? How you doing? Good to see you in here, sister. Good to see you. With that, some current events. So, in my particular case, and y'all can put down what's been going down currently with y'all, whether if it's in the particular state that you're in, or just the news that you've been watching. But for me, what I've been seeing really in the news right now is a lot of back and forth conversation about, of course, the transitioning and or whenever the transitioning is going to be for the next, you know, elect of a president, especially due to the rising numbers of CV within the U.S. And I know especially in California is pretty bad, if not one of the highest between here and New York. You know, don't quote me on those numbers. I'm not looking at the statistics as of right now. But you can look that up on NPR. A lot of different sites that have that information. So I've been seeing a lot of talk around that. As well as I've been hearing and seeing perspectives about, you know, getting the vaccine, not getting the vaccine, not trusting the effectiveness of the vaccine, and once again impeding on, you know, people's rights to practice whatever they want to end up practicing when it comes to, okay, this doesn't necessarily work for me. But once again, that's all everybody's perspective. At the end of the day, when it comes to that, is just really make sure you are doing the research, doing the knowledge, and seeing everything that has to concern with the vaccine, the administration, whatever else is going on in terms of the pandemic. Look at it from all the multiple sides, add them up, get what you need, and then base your perspective and your opinion around that. Basically, be more informed than uninformed. So let's see. It started 2 days ago. Biden's transition, I think. I have so many thoughts on that. Shoot, let me know. You're more than welcome to get on here. What are your thoughts? Please, I want to hear. They say both the Dakotas got hit the worst in my head from what I read. Fire's numbers go. You know what, y'all? I have a laptop for a reason. We have Google for a reason. So why not let me look this stuff up? But let's see. We can't leave. Y'all can't keep numbers. This block was the boss for your and you scheme, so don't. Yo, what's going on, Janet? Welcome to What's the Word Wednesdays. You are here with appreciate it. Now tell me, what's the word?
Honestly, because you were talking about the transition, and I'll be honest with you, like, I checked out the whole thing, and then not because I don't want to stay up to date, but it's more like, it's so consuming, it was turning very toxic, like, it just wasn't healthy anymore, and I mean, you know, that whole thing, who's the next president, the next 4 years. Like, I mean, he did it for a whole week. And it consumed the world. All that was on 24/7. And once he, like, officially put the gun, I was like, okay, you know what? At some point in time, he's going to have to transition. Like, from the there in office. But yeah. I think for me, what's bothering me is, like, people are like, oh my goodness, he's gonna go back to normal. I'm like, excuse my language, like, what the fuck does that even mean?
That is normal.
Like, back to, like, we're still experiencing racism, we're still experiencing poverty, oppression. Like, nothing is changing. Like, he's literally putting in the same people that were there during the Obama era. And, and like, I was telling folks, like, yeah, Obama was charismatic. He was the first black president. I think he gets let off the hook for many of those reasons. Like, he was young. He has two daughters. Like, he has a way with words that he knows how to captivate people. So yeah. I think that really...
But a con man has a way with words. So a charlatan, anybody can just, you know, be slick with the verbiage if they're trying to sell something to you. But continue.
Exactly. And so I think it's just, like, it's interesting because, like, I guess you could say folks that do have a more radical mindset that are in politics. I mean, they're in politics, so what does that say about them? But, like, that are a little bit more open to shifting the systems. None of those folks are getting put in his administration. And so I'm just, like, when we say we're going back to normal, like, understand, like, the Obama administration laid the foundation for a lot of things that Trump just kind of ran with. Like, I think of detention centers, the people over like Homeland Security, like ICE, those were during Obama era. Some of those folks were for George W. Bush.
Yep.
And I'm just like, y'all kind of spoon fed Trump into this pathway. Like, Trump didn't start this. He kind of just hyped it up even more. Like,
perpetuated it.
Exactly. And so I'm just like, I checked out for my own mental well-being because I was getting super sucked in. And I'm just like, with COVID, people of color dying at, like, disproportionate rates, and they're, like, wanting us to take the vaccine first. And I'm just like, no. We've seen how that's played out in history. No, especially in black communities. No, poor black communities. And we don't get a say. Y'all don't get a say. Like, nobody asks y'all what y'all want. They just go and say this. And so we're going to go ahead and do it. And then, like, be worse than before.
It's an unspoken dynamic that's been there since the beginning of the conception of this nation. So you are right on that. And another thing is, and this is where I always make sure that I take things with a grain of salt when it comes to even facts. When we say facts or data, you know, experiential experiences from people and just what we actually are observing and seeing. So we can pull up, if I want to, I can pull up and look up so many different data points when it comes to disproportionality within not only the foster care system, but the criminal justice system and the school system when it comes to black and also especially brown people being disproportionately affected by a certain thing. And the reason why is because the numbers are skewed. How are you going to have, in this particular case, I really don't know, because we're going to see what happens after the census. Don't forget, y'all, there's also a census this year. Remember, like, every 10 years, there's a census. So we're going to see what happens after the census. We'll see how much people are truly here in the population, but we're taking numbers from past. So there's 13%, if not roughly 12 to about 14% of the population within the U.S. is black. But in certain areas, they make up over, it could be close to 20 to almost 50% of certain things, like either in the prisons or within the foster care system. And then you ask and you wonder why, oh yeah, we need to target them, look at their numbers. It's very skewed. It's just like, how is that even the case? How do you get those numbers together? That looks like an improper fraction or a proper ratio to me. Like, how does that end up happening? But the way that it's always marketed, you have to really learn not only body language, but you need to learn vocabulary when it comes to being on the networks and watching the news. Because when different cases of stuff come out, they will use particular words to suggest if we're not talking about a race or a particular group. And what I mean by that is, if there's opiates or any, I'm just using an example, opiates is really affecting a certain community, they're not going to go out and say specifically what community is. It's going to keep on saying, like, the people.
The people.
And then when they want to push an agenda towards something, especially what they did with COVID-19, what they're going to end up doing is they're going to say, oh, yeah, black people are being affected this most. Oh, when you come to this, this is also being affected. Mm-hmm. What's up, Sue? Good to see you up in here. So what's the word? So when it comes to a lot of that, too, I don't only just take the data, you know, for what it is. You use it to help you interpretate and figure out what's going on around you. And of course, I'm not going to say my experience is 100% valid. You need to keep at it. But it is something that adds to the conversation, or it adds to that dialogue, to be like, okay, if we're saying this is an issue and we're seeing it being pushed again on people who are in low economic status, then, you know, why is that always the thing? You always have to take a note of that. But continue.
No. You bring up a great point, because for all we know, it's like the biggest issue. Like, I don't know, like who is, I don't know. But it really stuck with me, that part where you were talking about how we like to zoom in on certain populations when there's a certain agenda there, when it's convenient to folks. But then I think about the white community and I'm just like, we don't villainize them. Like, they don't get villainized in the news, but I'm just like, they're the ones out here causing a lot of the destruction too in our communities. Whether we're talking about the pandemic, mm-hmm. whether we're talking about environmental stuff, whether we're talking like environmental justice, everything, mm-hmm. Who's causing that damage, but who does it affect?
Yes.
At the end of the day. But then again, who's criminalized in the process? Who's villainized in the process? Who's blamed in the process? And who gets away with it? It's just so interesting to me. And I was reading an article about how they're doing more research on like the origins of like the virus, and like they still don't know, like, I don't know. And I just think it's so interesting how, not interesting, I'm not surprised, honestly, because that's not too far. Just the blame that Chinese people are like, you know, like you see a Chinese person on the street and it's just like, I don't want, like, I was watching a TV show and they're, you know, some TV shows are starting to incorporate the pandemic in there.
Yep.
And their storylines, and it's like, oh, but I don't want a Chinese doctor. And so I think about all these things that, like, who's villainized for it, but who continues to create more damage and harm? We don't focus on that. I don't know. It's very interesting.
Well, I love the point that you brought up with that. And what happens is, and I see this really as an American value, is complacency. So getting comfortable. So it's so much easier to just let things go and be what they are versus really challenging and pushing to affect some type of change. And the reason why is, if you got to, go ahead. The reason why is because...
I'm so sorry. Someone's at my door. I have to go. I'm so sorry.
Handle it.
I'll try and hop in. This is good stuff. I'm sorry.
Go ahead. Okay. So, continuing on with that point, when I'm just saying, this is from my perspective, take a grain of salt, but we have this American ideal, to me, that it comes to, you know, complacency, where literally once you've worked hard towards all that you needed, you can chill. So that means you don't have to end up working are really doing anything at all. So, you know, you can sleep until, you know, literally you're dead. But what ends up happening there is we begin to basically blind ourselves in our vision when it comes to really seeing justice or injustices and approaching them, or even just questioning, okay, why does that end up happening? Well, it's not happening in my immediate reality, so it has nothing to do with me. That is true to a certain extent. But once again, can you truly be off the hook when it comes to anything in certain aspects? Because either way, the choice that you make is going to have an impact on that result whether or not you wanted to make the choice or not. And when it comes to, we can just, you know, say, you know, racism and a lot of the institutionalized capitalism and racism, you know, non-action is actually also not helpful at all either. But once again, it really just it gets down to the point, you know, of, you know, if it has nothing to do with me, I'm comfortable, I'm chilling, I ain't gotta worry about that. And the system is working just fine the way it is because it's in my benefit. Knowing that it doesn't benefit the vast majority. But that's pretty dope. I'm glad. Thank you, Janet, for jumping in. More than welcome to come back in. Anybody else too, be able to do the same. Then we're gonna continue with this. But anything else y'all have seen or heard when it comes to current events, things happening around us in the world, please throw them down in the comments or jump on with your boy and let me know. What's the word? Now, continuing. Anything else currently that has had my attention? I've been peeking back and forth still with the whole idea with stimulus checks. It's still a roundabout thing. Now they've pushed it back to where there's a possibility now that, one, they'll be able to get checks out much faster because they've worked with, and you don't quote me on this, the IRS to find faster ways to basically get it to the American people. And they're looking at, now they pushed it back, whether they're looking at late December, early January for stimulus checks to hit the Americans, all of us, the population. So we will see how that goes, but at this point it's like they playing hopscotch, they playing, you know, catch back and forth, and nobody necessarily ready to run to the touchdown or just put a stamp on it and be like, all right, let's go. And, you know, I don't know all of the major details and certain affiliations to why, you know, Republicans, Democrats, House, Senate, how they all are in there, what they're trying to bargain and get in out of that process. So I get it. I can definitely say I don't know. And I'm okay with that. And I'll continue to look up more so then I can be more well-informed. But that's just you give me giving a little small update is that they're still playing around with the idea of it, then projected towards the end of December, early January. Now, the other thing, like I was speaking on earlier, just with the vaccines and just a lot of that talk when it comes to that getting out. Spoke on it last time. They're aiming towards somewhere in between mid-April going to May to at least have a number. I'm going to say it was like 1.3 billion of the population to be vaccinated. And there's a lot of information that can be given to it. You can look up different articles and different health journals to track and look at how really not only viruses and other different diseases are tracked and learn about it and the methods of how it is effectively created so that it is inherently safe for the population and just safe for people in general. Now, in my perspective, it's just be careful. Watch who they're trying to give it to, how it's being done, and the reasoning behind whether or not there's only going to be a need of one dose, two dose, multiple doses, just to make sure that it's fine. All I can say is just be wary. Be wary. Weary. And that means make sure that you're just aware of that fact, knowing, not the fact, but just be aware of knowing that those are possibilities and figuring out what your choice is going to be when it comes to exploring a lot of that, so you can have that information and be informed on your decision. But other than that, there's not much I've gotten to see else besides just hearing about the transition, presidents, the CV results, and how they're spiking, and how further along they are with creating multiple different vaccines. So that's what wraps up at least four current events. If there's any more, please throw them in there, y'all. But we're gonna move to the next topic, which this one, it is all from my perspective, and it might be information out there, but we're gonna talk about the four levels of understanding. Now, when we think of the word understanding, y'all tell me, what are the first things that come to mind when you think of the word understanding? In my particular case, when I think of the word understanding, me, it's basically getting, it's a process that is done in the mind to help you figure out a problem or a situation from a base level. So when we think of understanding, I'm really thinking of at it at a base level and how that helps to continue to build on further your knowledge and your comprehension to an issue or a problem. So that's what I think of when we think of understanding. So, yeah. Oh, you're good. You're good. Janet, you're more than welcome to come back in. I'm talking about the four levels of understanding, and those being from my perspective as I've gathered my own, you know, experience and knowledge around it. But when you think of understanding, tell me in the comments, like, what do you think of when you first hear understanding? But from the dictionary, dictionary.com, this is what they have for the definition of understanding. So they have it as a noun, and it is mental process of a person who comprehends, is comprehension, personal interpretation, intellectual faculties, intelligence, as well as the mind. Is also superior power of discernment, enlightened intelligence, knowledge of or familiarity with a particular thing, skilled in dealing with or handling something. And another one, a state of cooperative or mutual tolerance between people. So an understanding. And then the adjective they have, and then we'll continue off, which is characterized by understanding, prompted by, based on, or demonstrating comprehension, intelligence, discernment, empathy, or the like. So that's all of those for understanding, just definition-wise. And once again, when I speak of all these words and looking them up and seeing that there is not one cohesive definition or one true definition of a word, you see that it can create miscommunication and also misunderstanding on things. Now, since we got that for understanding, so these are the four levels of understanding from my perspective of me not only just listening to other people, but dissecting the word, understanding just to a little bit, to a certain extent, not to a full extent, and putting logic behind the four levels I'm going to speak on. So the first level of understanding, of course, is understanding. And with that, like I said earlier, for me, understanding is just the base. It is the foundation of all that you're seeking to know, learn, and grasp when it comes to a particular skill, issue, situation, etc., and so forth. So when you have an understanding, picture this as a table. And when I mean at a table, you can talk about either if it is like a park bench or even just a lunch table, if any of you remember going to school and how the lunch tables were. But understanding basically is the ground that the lunch table is set on. That lunch table is the information or that skill or what you're getting. So let's get that again. So the lunch table is the information or that skill or the thing that you are learning about. Understanding is setting that foundation for that. So the ground is that understanding that for this table to be up here, this is what I need to lay down on it. I need for it to be on the ground where it's at. And there, that's where you get just the perspective of that's what the table is for. It's just I'm laying that down so that the table can be supported on this ground that I have right here. Now, after you've been able to get at least a base understanding of that particular issue, thing, or the information, move to the second level, which is understanding. And how I look at understanding is being able to grab the information of that skill, whatever it may end up being, and now take that to the next level within yourself and see how that has an impact on you. So in our metaphor of the table, and now the understanding was the ground. Now, the understanding is how the table impacts you. And that could be you sitting at the table. So now we're adding you there in the table. So that comes to the point of saying, I found out information on, and I use a math example. Find out how to say that literally 10 times 10 is 100. Cool. I understand that 10 times 10 is 100. To take it a step further, to bring it into understanding, is now how does knowing 10 times 10 have an impact on me as an individual? And you can say, well, now I'm able to grasp and just quickly remember, oh yeah, 10 times 10 is 100. And with having that, oh, that can help me already be able to get my mind moving and running, as well as when I go up to the next grade, or if I am thinking on my feet when it comes to finances, okay, I already know 10 times 10 is 100, and that's going to help me with my finances. And that's just the example there. But with those two first levels, it's basically starting at the base, and now you're starting to work upward, and now coming, like I said, understanding is now it's within. How does that impact you as a person inside? Now, once you've gotten to the understanding of the information, problem, situation, etc., you've came to understand that information, situation, problem, and etc. Now we go on to the third level, which is overstanding. And when I speak on overstanding, you're going to see I'm playing around with a lot of these words. So we have understanding, understanding, overstanding. So when it comes to overstanding, basically, you can see each one of them are a switch of perspectives. So understanding is you have a perspective at the base, and it can be seen as you looking up towards something. Understanding, now you're moving up and you have the perspective of how that has an impact on you and inside. So now you're moving up, not just from under, particularly you're talking about under the table being our foundation, but being at that table. And once you do that, you have the overstanding, which overstanding is basically, if I get a good comparison, it's like a bird's eye, almost close to a bird's eye view, where now you've seen it under here, you've grasped it inside, now you're seeing how does that have an effect on the environment and the people around you. So now going back to the math, I'm using a lot of metaphors, so let me know if they're making sense or not, and if they're not, please put it in the comments. Now knowing 10 times 10, or understanding 10 times 10, just to have the information, that was the base. Now, understanding that 10 times 10 can help me move to the next grade, help me with finances, or be able to get my mind critically, or just working at some quick math facts. Now we come to how does the give me an overstanding? And when it comes to that, how does that impact everybody else around you? How does knowing 10 times 10 impact everybody else around them? So if everybody else is able to know what 10 times 10 is, everybody else is able to be on that same level, or they're able to have that same perspective or that knowledge of, okay, if I have 10 times 10 and I know that's 100, this is how much I can end up making. This is how much they can end up making. This is how we can all incorporate this together to make our environment either greater or worse. Just because, you know, in 10 times 10. I know it can sound ridiculous, but just follow along with me. Now, with the overstanding, basically you have, once again, I said that bird's eye view, you have a greater range and aspect of knowing, okay, now that table's there. It's on the foundation. I've come to understand how important that table is to me and how that works. Now I see if the outer standing is, okay, now how's that table important to other people? People can come and join the table. People can end up helping to move the table another else place. It can provide basically comfort for a number of people within that community. So getting it to an outer overstanding, I already got to the fourth one, overstanding, you're able to not only step outside of yourself and be able to empathize and see another person's or listen to another person's perspective, you are able to have a more well-rounded and concrete understanding, understanding, and overstanding of an issue, problem, situation, information, etc. And that was the third, that's the third level. Now the fourth level of understanding, and this is all from my perspective, like I said, it could be information out there about this, or it could not, and this could just be, like I said, my own knowledge, my own understanding of stuff. But fourth, we have an outer standing, which I will say shouts out to my brother Longo of really bringing that concept. And it just made me like, wow, that makes a lot of sense when we think about it in different levels. Now, when we think of outer standing, now we're going even further past the overstanding. Outer standing now, it reaches out to within the world, the universe. Basically, we have the micro to the macro, which means we got the small to the very, very big and large. So an outer standing on an issue, problem, situation, information, etc., brings that full circle of now how does that affect this entire world, this entire universe, if you want to think further, almost to another spiritual realm, the infinite knowledge of how, where I talk, where I speak on the infinite knowledge or infinite intelligence, and you really grasping and knowing information, problem, situation, skill, etc. Basically open up the critical thinking even further. So bringing it back to the math, and then we'll go back again to the table. So we have the math and the table. Now, with knowing or understanding that 10 times 10 is 100, understanding that 10 times 10 is 100, how it affects you, overstanding that 10 times 10 is 100 and how that affects the environment and the people around you, the outer standing of knowing 10 times 10 is 100, how does that affect the immediate world and the universe around you? Because there is a such thing as numerology, and people study numbers and how they code things. We can talk about the matrix. We got all of that when it comes to coding. I mean, we, our birth certificate is numbers. What, our driver's license, not only letters, but it's numbers. You know, birthday, we were born. Those are numbers. So any way that we converse and we have conversation and talks, that is one of the universal languages, which math is numbers, universal language. Everyone around the world knows about numbers and math in some way, shape, or form, whether if it is addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, later on trigonometry, all the way past pre-calculus, further on. But having an outer standing of what 10 times 10 equals 100 shows you or gives you is that literally you are able to connect all the way close to the source of how that has a dramatic impact back down to the understanding. So again, like I said, it creates that full circle of really having that knowledge. And while you're acquiring that information and turning that, you grasp the knowledge so well that it becomes what we say, wisdom, because you've put it into action. You've taken it through those four levels. And now with that outer standing, you are able to pinpoint and connect within your own environment. Okay, I see now that 10 times 10 is 100. How it affects the universe and the world around me is that if people are not able to learn this concept of 10 times 10 is 100, there's a lot of people that's going to suffer when it comes to, we have poverty. There's an issue with poverty. We have an issue of maybe even reading because of the fact that they didn't know if they do the 10 times 10 and learn their math, they still have to have some point of reading. So that can also have an effect on literacy. Not knowing 10 times 10 is 100 can also be to a point where you can be taken advantage of because other people know it, but you do not know it. And you don't understand and overstand, understand and outerstand how that has an effect. I know it can sound goofy and all of that, but it comes to show you how close to any and everything, if you're able to track it and find not only just the logic that you put into it with examples, but use information that you find, facts, statistics, books, your own observations going out into nature, you're able to see the full circle of how everything and anything is connected. Even if you try and stretch it, you see that it can become fully connected back. And when you have those four levels, which there's at times where you're not going to get to every single level, but as you work towards on that specific topic, issue, information, etc., you're able to have a greater knowledge and a greater perspective, which might turn into wisdom, can turn into wisdom. You're now able to share that and give that out to other people to add to their perspective and to add to their knowledge to go do the knowledge and research and have all of this. So when they're ready and good to go to tackle the particular issue, et cetera, they're good to go. They at least have some type of prep work. Now, when it comes to the table, again, now with the outer standing, now you see how does this table have an effect to the world and everything in the universe and stuff around it? Well, now you see that the table has a role to play within the community, and it provides a necessary need not only for yourself but for the people that are there in the community, but it can also shine light on different concepts or different values, maybe being consistent, maybe being strong and firm. Because, and I'll throw in some knowledge from at least what I've gotten to know when it comes to Egyptians and during a time in Kemet, is when it came to a lot of values, principles, and concepts, a lot of them were used in ways of ideographs, which is basically images of not only people, but them depicted with animal-like features. And what they did is they used animals and those different features to symbolize concepts, maybe of courage, maybe of wisdom, of balance. And each one of those features added to the full range of understanding, understanding, overstanding, and outerstanding of not only where they were, but them as individuals, them as a community, and them as a bigger, wider world within this universe and this world that they're in. So all of that coming together with those four levels, if you're able to take any particular thing, I just use the math and I use just that table concept. But if you're able to try to apply not just only from the understanding, but move it to understanding, then to an overstanding, then to reach out to an outer standing, you're able to see how that truly connects, and you're able to have more of a well-rounded perspective on things. And like I said, you can add in books, statistics, you know, research, your own experiences, and just daily observations. But if any of y'all have comments, questions on it, please throw them in here, as well as please to ask me later if you need to DM, and I can give a little bit more explanation around it. But those are the four levels. The four levels again: understanding, understanding, overstanding, and outerstanding. And now, to wrap up and get towards the end of the show, we have the last topic, which in this particular case is basically adding in now how, or I should say where, does true learning come from? And that was just a question I was thinking and posing to myself. Because when we always speak on and talk about, well, you know, you still got to learn. Okay. Now, can you tell me, what do you mean by, you know, learn? And like, what do I need to learn? Well, you need to learn how to drive a car. Okay, well, why do I need to learn how to drive a car? And you continue to have these, once again, these thoughts in this process. And then you come to the reason, okay, then where does this come from? Okay, where does this whole idea of, like, I truly need to learn this, where does this come from? How does this truly impact me and help me when it comes to living this life? How do I truly live this life? What do I truly need to learn to be successful at being human? Well, from my perspective, and any of y'all can jump in and you can get it from your own too. And for those who are just coming in too, I've moved on from the four levels of understanding, which was understanding, interstanding, overstanding, and outerstanding. And now I'm on to now where does true learning come from? Now, from what I've come to gather, where true learning stems from, it begins before you're even here. And what I mean is, as you're just a concept or a baby being born, there are certain traits and innate abilities that you already have, but you grasped and got that from your mother. You've got that information from your father, and it's traced deep within your DNA. And depending on those situations, that's where those different strands are brought out of you depending on certain situations. So when you're thinking of true learning, you're really going back to within you. How does that impact the coding and information from your mom and dad DNA and affect you as a being? So you truly learn, okay, when you come out, you're like, okay, this is the particular, you can say, race that I am. Okay, my body needs this particular food to survive. Okay, which a lot of it starts off very similar. But as you get older, you start to see a lot of disinformation that is quoted as true learning. So we can speak on history. We speak on colonization of indigenous and tribal and aboriginal folks around the world, and see how that learning in itself and how it is shifted and changed and manipulated and is seen as true learning. And I'm using this in air quotes, because at the end of the day, a lot of things are both a half truth and a half lie. There's not a lot of absolutes in this world, because something that is absolute, there is no arguing, or there is no reasoning around it. And when I mean reasoning, it is what it is, and it is what has been made. Now, as you grow up, you learn all this information, you're programmed with things that are supposed to be applied to you to help further your understanding of the world around you and how you're supposed to move and how you're supposed to survive, you start to come in question, well, I'm following, in this particular case, for being in the U.S., following this American dream. And I see that as I'm following this American dream that's been set, there is not only certain boundaries, invisible ones, there's a lot of physical ones, as well as it's not set up for every single person to be truly successful. And the reason why is as you dig deeper and you start to get to that point where, what I mean by true learning, basically, of what is needed for you to be successful and applies to you to help you push further, you begin to learn that, well, the way that the United States is set up as a business, as a corporation with capitalism, there has to be winners and there has to be losers. There is no in between. Everybody gets to be on the same, because if not, people will start saying that it's Marxism, socialism, etc. So you come to see that at the end of the day, a lot of this is rigged. And what was given to you as true learning of what you need to learn to be successful, to get where you need to get, doesn't apply to you. And I'm not only just speaking about just particular races and speaking about Black, Indigenous, people of color. This applies also to white people, because there is a such thing as different trailer parks, and deep down south there's poor white classism. It's another system, another ism. So when it comes to this true learning, the point of what true learning is supposed to do is supposed to help you use true critical thinking. I should say true. Need to stop with the truth. But use critical thinking to help further your growth as a person, an individual, that eventually affects the environment, your community, and continues to affect the world and the universe around you. So, where does it come from? And I'm back at that point. It starts from within. It starts from once you are thought of in this world, between your parents, in that connection. And then how is it developed? As you continue to grow, you're born, you're conceived, and you continue to work and learn, whether it's at school, at home, which home is the first basic foundation for learning, observational learning. You continue to also see TV, working a job, career, etc. But that true learning, its main point is to equip you with what's necessary for you to strive to be not only a critical thinker, but to be able to analyze and be able to grow multiple ways mentally, physically, spiritually, emotionally, socially, all the above. So that is where, from my perspective, true learning comes from. And it becomes true depending on the person. But if y'all have anything, please throw it in the comments. We're already winding down. We got about 2 more minutes left. I appreciate everyone that is here, as well as those who are going to view this after, either here or another platform that I place it on. But to put it all into summary of the whole show, with current events, the main things I've seen has been more around the transition, the president, the rising numbers, especially in the U.S., the talks of multiple vaccines, current event-wise, as well as the back and forth still with the stimulus. With the four levels on understanding, those four are understanding, so the base, understanding how that has an impact on you as an individual and person within, overstanding how that information has an impact on not only you, but the environment and the people around you. And fourth, understanding how that information, etc., has an impact on not only you, the community, people around you, but the entire world as well as the universe. So to a higher spiritual point. And those are the four levels of understanding. And lastly, where does true learning come from? Starts within. It begins with you being born or still within the womb with your mom, created between the union. And it is continued throughout your life with the main purpose of giving you the tools and information necessary to help with your critical thinking and to promote well-being towards your goals in life. And with all of that, appreciate y'all. This has been another episode of What's the Word Wednesdays, episode 19. I've been your host, your brother Advis. I will see y'all next time, next station. But at the end of the day, keep pushing. Keep your pace, patience, awareness, consistency, and empathy. And I will see y'all. Peace. One love. We out.